So let's first start with variable modifiers. So when we talk about basic types such as int or char, we may have their characteristics modified, particularly how many bits are stored in these data types and are they signed, which means that you can have negative numbers and it's stored typically in 2 complement, or are they only positive numbers. Therefore, you can use a modifier, and an example is given here. So I have an integer myInt, and I want it to be signed, and I want it to be shorter. So there are a couple of modifiers. Shorter makes the length shorter in fewer bits. Longer makes it longer typically, which means more bits. You can use something like long, which makes it longer than long. Signed means you have a sign. Data is to be stored in the 2 complement for those data types here. And unsigned means you don't have a sign. So note that for a typical integer, the actual length is system specific. So you may have on a 16-bit CPU different data types than on a 32-bit. Nowadays it doesn't matter too much because you have the length of these types is bigger, but in the embedded market it's still relevant. In contrast of using any of those, I would recommend use a fixed length that is clear from our standard int header, such as int32t. In this type, you know it's 32 bits and it is unsigned, assigned, sorry. Otherwise it would be uint for unsigned int, as we've learned before. Why do I show this slide? Well, because you see a lot of these data types still in existing code. That's why you have to understand a little bit what they are doing. So next modifier we talk about is the constants. You specify such a data type by using the const keyword. So here I have a valid identifier such as numPlanets, which is of type int, and I add const, which makes it a constant number. That means it cannot be changed ever again. Well, as you have to somehow set a number initially, you have, when you declare such a variable that is constant, you have to assign it immediately to an expression. So as usual, as we will see, how do I read such a declaration? I read it from right to left. So I would say numPlanets is a constant integer. So the compiler will check that you do not modify this variable. If you do it, then it produces either a warning or error depending on the settings. Some programmers use capitals for constants, but it's really up to you. I'm not doing that. So you may ask, why do I use constants and not just a variable without constant, normal variable? Well, you may actually accidentally change it, right? So that happens, and you may not have fully understood an API, and you may accidentally change it, which leads to unintended side effects. It's very useful for functions because it clarifies the meaning sometimes of an argument. And second question you may ask is why you don't just use a literal. So instead of saying the numPlanets is, well, 8 plus 1, you could say it's just, you know, 9. Well, the variable allows us to maintain the semantical meaning. So by reading numPlanets, I understand what it means, right? I have a better understanding than just reading 9. And secondly, I can have one place in my program where I change the definition of such a variable, and then the value changes all over our program. So when we use short or long and any data type, it's sometimes useful to determine the size of these types. So sizeof is a built-in function that you can use that returns the number of bytes of memory that are used to store a specific type. So I can say sizeof int32t, and then it will return the number of bytes that you need, in this case 4. You can also use it for those types like short int, and then you figure out how many bytes there are on your machine. It also works for float and double, of course. So you can, instead of using it on a data type, you can also use it on a variable. So here we have p, which is a short integer. And we can say size of p, and then we know how many bytes it has. So next, let's talk a little bit more about values and typecasting. So what is the value? Well, a value of a variable is the meaning of the contents of an object when you interpret it as having a specific type. Okay? Wow, that is a long sentence. Well, what does it mean? Here we see the number 5, and we assign this to the integer type variable a. So this a now will be an object of type integer. So whatever this number was, will be converted and interpreted to be of the type int, which is our signed two complement number. Okay? So now what you can do, you can cast, which means to convert the values between variables of different types. For instance, here what we want to create, we create a floating point variable b, and we use our integer variable a and multiply it by 0.5. Okay, 0.5 by itself, by the way, is a floating point number. So we multiply a whole number with a floating point number. And in this case, it triggers an implicit type conversion, which means the compiler will understand that it has to convert this integer number here to a floating point number and create a result that is as well a floating point number. Okay, this is automatically done by the compiler. And this kind of conversion preserves typically the value. So the result of 5 times 0.5 will be 2.5, right? But you may lose a little bit of precision when you go from integer to floating point numbers, particularly for 64-bit integers. There exists also a couple of implicit type conversions that do not lose precision. For example, when you input a 32-bit integer variable and save it into a 64-bit variable. So that doesn't change anything. So anytime we assign a variable, the compiler will have to check that if the data representation on the right-hand side matches the left-hand side, and if it does not, we have to do this kind of implicit conversion or an explicit conversion, which we'll talk about in a minute. So why would you want to store variables of different type in the first place? Well, reason could be that you have to match a given function type, or that you want to actually preserve memory, which is particularly true when you talk about embedded devices. So a programmer can ask for explicit conversion between any possible types. So I can take a floating point variable b, assign it to 3. 3 is, by the way, an integer, so this gets implicitly converted into our floating point representation. And now, later I want to assign it to an integer. And if I would remove this piece here, this explicit conversion, the compiler would argue that this isn't possible. It doesn't make sense for it, because most of the time, floating point values are outside of the range of an integer value. But if you know what you are doing, then you can ask for this explicit typecasting, which means you have to put in bracket our target type, and then you put in the variable or expression that you want to convert, and then the compiler will create the representation of this data type, and now it can assign, in this case, this data type to our variable a, to our object, right, our object of our type a, which is interpreted as being of type integer. Okay, when you do explicit typecasting, you have to beware of programming errors. Here is a correct syntax usage, but it leads to an unexpected error, which is a crash. And you find all those codes in our Git repository such that you can try and play with them. So what I do here, I take a number and I basically interpret this number as this object of file star, which we talk about next in 2 weeks time, what this means. And then we assign it, and then we operate on this object P, which is of this type, but data type file star, and that will crash our program. So here we have now an example to kind of practice this a very little bit. Have a look at this code, at the different data types, and then try to figure out what this code will print And here we do, of course, some explicit typecasting and make your educated guess. Okay, now let's move on and discuss the solution. Right, I hope you have paused the video. Well, here we print our integer I as integer. That's not a problem, so it will print 3. Then we print j. J, we assign the ASCII number for the literal 1 in the ASCII table. So, but we print it again as a character, so we see character 1. And now we do a cast of J, which was basically our decimal number 1. And we convert it and cast it to an integer, and we print it now as an integer, which means we would see what ASCII number it basically will have. Next, we take our floating point number, which is 3.14, and cast it to an integer. Well, an integer cannot hold any decimal fraction. So we will just print number 3 in this case, instead of 3.14.